Ну, можете здесь управлять, да? Потому что это тяжело. Вот на этом.
Был ровная поверхность чела.
А так она будет ползать. Не, вот так еще бы, значит, не уходил.
Universității Moldovei, a reprezentat dezvoltarea relațiilor științifice internaționale, încheierea acordurilor de colaborare științifică cu partenerii din străinătate și promovarea acțiunilor de integrare în spațiul științific european. Prin un program ambițios lansat în anul 2018, s-a asociat Republica Moldova și implicit Comunitatea Științifică Națională. A fost programul cadru al Comunității Europene pentru Cercetare și Dezvoltare Tehnologică, la acel moment cel mai important instrument de finanțare a cercetării în Uniunea Europeană.
Issues of supramolecular and coordinative chemistry regarding the synthesis of new compounds, the use of structure and physicochemical methods for studies of solid, liquid and gaseous phases, the use of coordination compounds for human needs. At the conference, we will be presenting the results for recent research related to important directions in chemistry, such as synthesis of new carnation compounds, the chemistry of polycyclic, macrocyclic and polymer compounds, of supramolecular systems, biocoordination compounds of P complexes and application in catalysis, magnetochemistry and spectrochemistry, nanochemistry, quantum and structure chemistry of carnation compounds, thermodynamics and kinetics of complex formation, molecular design, molecular and electronic structure study. And the conference attended more than 150 scientists. The program includes 15 communications in plenary session, 14 oral presentations organized in two sessions by section, and 130 posters presented by scientists from 12 countries, including France, Germany, Italy, Japan, Moldova, Poland, Romania, Russia, Belarus, Spain, Ukraine, UK, and USA. I would like to cordially greet the Vice President of Russia Academy of Science, Academician Mikhail Aldoshin, the Vice President of the Romanian Academy of Science, Academician Bogdan Simionescu, the Vice President of the Polish Academy of Science, Academician Janusz Lipkowski, the our colleagues, great scientist, Professor Andrew Benniston from UK, Professor Marius Andruh and Professor Ioniel Mangalagiu from Romania, Professor Rudolf Clerac, Professor Marius Reglie and Professor Sebastian Floquet from France, Professor Juan Bartolomé and Professor Fernando Bartolomé from Spain, Professor Donald Poirier, Canada, Professor Annie Powell and Professor Christophe Janiak from Germany. Dear guests, dear colleagues, in this report I will present some achievements and coordination in supramolecular chemistry, and I dedicate it to academician Constantin Turte, doctor habilitated in chemistry, professor, famous scientist, renowned chemist, person of culture and noble attitude. Scientist Constantin Turte was a worldwide specialist in the bioinorganic and coordination chemistry. He became known in the scientific community by his fundamental pioneering work on the application of Mössbauer spectroscopy in organic and coordination chemistry. Dear colleagues, for our guests who are visiting Moldova for the first time, I would like to say a few words about our country. The Republic of Moldova lies in the central part of Europe in the northeastern Balkans. Moldova occupies an area of 33 square kilometers. On the north, east and south, Moldova is neighbor of Ukraine. And on the west, it is bordered from Romania by the Prut River. The Academy of Science of Moldova is the highest scientific forum of Moldova, founded in 12th of June 1946. Academy of Science includes 48 research institutions. At present, the academic corps of the Academy of Science consists of 47 the full members and 42 corresponding members and 38 honoris members. The performance in chemistry is carried out by 7 research institutions and 7 universities of Moldova. Currently, we have over 800 researchers, chemists, working in the institutions. 25% are young researchers. The Institute of Chemistry of the Academy of Science of Moldova was founded in 1910. 59. Now the institute includes physical chemistry and nanocomposite center, which is three laboratories, center for research and study of water quality for two laboratories, and four independent laboratories. Nowadays, the Faculty of Chemistry of Moldovan State University includes two departments, chemistry, and second department is industrial and ecological chemistry, 40 doctors habilitate professors, 29 PhD in chemistry, associate professors, senior lectures, 19 university lectures, and 12 assistants. The University of the Academy of Science of Moldova includes Department of Physics and Chemistry and is in close collaboration with the Institute of Chemistry by training young specialists. This slide presents Big Bang theory, explaining the evolution of the universe. Professor Jean-Marie Len, a Greek chemist, which was awarded the Nobel Prize in supramolecular chemistry, in base of this theory, represent of the evolution of science. As you see in this picture, Big Bang began with physical processes from elementary particles. After come chemistry, atoms and molecules, and the final results, the enormous diversity of organized and intelligent complexes, structure of matter, supramolecules, living organisms, which are the subject of biology. As you see on the slide, chemistry is the bridge between physics and biology. Chemistry today is an interdisciplinary science that integrates knowledge from various sciences, including from physics, mathematics, biology, and other. An important case is coordination chemistry, which later led to the development of supramolecular chemistry. When we talk about coordination compounds, there is no way to ignore physical methods such as infrared, NMR, UV-VIS, Mössbauer spectroscopy, mass spectrometry, and so on. What are the global trends of chemistry today? First is the health and ecosystems. Second is sustainable energy. And the last, but traditional, is a technological development. The Nobel Prize winner in chemistry for 2014 has demonstrated the importance for research in chemistry by improving physicochemical methods of study of superior chemical structure. An example, supramolecules. And the recent yesterday Nobel Prize winners in chemistry have discovered the mechanism of DNA repair, thus convincing us again that chemical research of macromolecules of biological importance has good perspective and its future development is highly appreciated and encouraged. Main importance and use of this org is development of new cancer treatments. What are research direction in chemistry of chemistry in Moldova? The major trends of development of chemistry in Moldova are first nanocomposites. Now, synthesis and study of nanoscale chemical compounds. Second, biotechnology. Synthesis of biologically active compounds, and the last, environment, the chemical and physicochemical study of processes in nature. In the last 2 years, the state program in chemistry in Moldova took place. design of chemical substances and directing the architecture of materials for various applications. The purpose of the state program is to obtain new chemical substances and polyfunctional materials with the predetermined their properties. These substances and materials can be used in medicine, nanotechnology, and agriculture. As we all know, coordination chemistry in Moldova was founded and led by academician Antonio Ablov. Academician Antonio Ablov studied the effect of trans interaction of deoxymate cobalt compounds, elaboration of method for synthesis of transition elements complexes with the polydentate ligands and study of magnetic interaction of polynuclear compounds exchange. Concepts and laws of template assembly of macrocyclic and supramolecular systems, including highly polynuclear clusters, were fundamented by academician Nikolai Gerbelev. Correspondent member Dr. Habilitatus Mikhail Revenko is a disciple of academician Nikolai Gerbelev. Professor Mihai Revenko was the first Moldavian chemist who used coordination process in analytical chemistry. More detailed information about scientific activity of Professor Mihai Revenko will be presented later today by academician Professor Aurelian Gulia. Personalities who have significantly contributed to the development of coordination and supramolecular chemistry in Moldova are academician Aurelian Gulia, academician Isaac Bersukher, Professor Dumitru Batyr, Professor Ion Bulhak, Professor Yuri Simonov, Professor Vladimir Arion, Professor Grigory Timko, Professor Viktor Kravtsov. I will give special attention to the research which fundamental character conducted by academician Konstantin Turte, which were focused on solving the original problem of synthesis of mono and polynuclear compounds of iron, of biologically active coordination compounds and nanomaterials. Mössbauer spectroscopy application in chemistry. Academician Turte was many years director of Laboratory of Bioinorganic Chemistry and Nanocomposites. The main direction of research of the laboratory is presented in this slide. At the very beginning, the interest of academician Turte was focused on the synthesis and study of the molecular heterocyclic iron containing trinuclear carboxylates. This class of compounds is able to provide an opportunity to study many spin coupling interactions in the system with the same configuration. Another significant result of the synthesis and study of novel tetranuclear iron lanthanide clusters, which displays interesting Mössbauer spectra and the magnetic behavior. In continuation, a series of new tetranuclear complexes of iron with 11 different lanthanides have been prepared. The crystal structure of all clusters are isostructural and have a non-planar butterfly core. In collaboration with Professor Juan Bartolomé, the intermolecular exchange interaction within the single molecule magnet butterfly molecule were determined and combined experimental and theoretical work. Late, a new family of isostructural undernuclear mixed iron and lanthanide cluster was synthesized. The central ferrum core of the coordination cluster can be described in terms of two ferrum butterfly motifs sharing a common body ferrum atom. Heteropolynuclear iron clusters find application in various scientific fields. The main goal of this work presented in this slide was the application of oxo-Brigid cluster containing ferrum-2-cuprum-4 core as precursors for the preparation of more efficient nano-sized catalytic systems for the Bignelli reactions. On this slide, you can see the synthetic route of nano-sized catalytic systems from heteropolynuclear iron complexes and their application for Bignelli reaction. High temperature solution phase reaction of iron for what in sunflower oil in the presence of trichloroacetic acid and 1.2-hexadecylamine presents another method for synthesis of ferrum-2-3 nanoparticles with sizes about 1.3 nanometer in diameter. One more direction of academician Turte was synthesis and study of heteropolynuclear iron manganese clusters that exhibit significant magnetic properties as molecular magnets. The last year, I participated together with academician Turte at the creation of one of the most important directions of research, electrochemical and photocatalytical production of hydrogen from water. This research was developed in the frame of 57 European program by young scientists from three countries, United Kingdom, Supervisor Professor Beniston, Romania, Supervisor Professor Mangalaciu, and Moldova, Supervisor Academician Turte. The results were published in Springer. I would like to propose Professor Beniston and Professor Mangalaciu to continue this important project in Horizon 2020. In the frame of bilateral France-Moldova program and project, it was initiated a synthesis and study of artificial models for active centers of hydrogenase. In collaboration with Professor Reglier, Université de Marseille, France, new clusters of iron and nickel with ligands containing nitrogen and sulfur have been obtained. They can be seen as potential models for hydrogenase. Academician Constantin Turte had a fruitful collaboration with Dr. Maria Kazaku and Academician Bogdan Simenescu from Petroponi Institute of Macromolecular Chemistry, Iași, Romania. Among the main achievements is the synthesis of coordination compounds of ferrum, manganum and cobalt with sheave-based ligands containing siloxane fragments. The work of Academician Turte was very important to us and Academy of Science of Moldova decided to nominate the annual award for most relevant scientific results obtained in chemistry in his name. And honor Academy of Science of Moldova Prize in Chemistry, Constantin Turte. Thank you. I once again welcome all the participants of the conference to Chișinău. I hope that these 2 days will be fruitful for all and will create a new scientific research. new collaborations and new scientific projects in the frame of the Horizon 2020. Because according to José Manuel Barroso, the future of Europe is in the science. And for us, for Moldova, Moldova's future is in Europe of science. I want to present key person of our conference, academician Aurelian Gulea. He is co-president of the organization committee, Dr. Vasily Lozan, co-president, and Dr. Vadim Druce, secretary of the conference. Dear participants of the conference, I invite you to visit the photo gallery, chemical photo gallery, or photo gallery of Moldavian chemists, major part, in the hall. Author of this photo gallery is Eugenia Tofan, head of the Media Center of Academy of Science of Moldova. And I invite also to visit the Academy of Science Museum in the first floor right or left. Is right when you another just want and thank you for your attention. On behalf of the Academy of Science of Moldova, I want to just give some information. Please, Professor Gulea.
Dear colleagues, the participants, we have the honor to announce you that the highest prize of Moldova Academy of Sciences, the Medal of Dmitry Cantemir, was awarded to the Professor Alexandru Cecal. Collaboration with the Institute of Chemistry, Moldova State University, and the Institute of Microbiology and Technology.
As is a brevet for Medal Dmitry Cantemir, my congratulations.
I was surprised for this distinction which I received from Academy of Science of Republic Moldova. I think for me it's a very, very pleasure to see that our collaboration for more than 25 years with our colleagues from right side of Prut, from Moldova Republic, was fruitful. I regret that my age not permitted to continue because I retired, but I was I was very glad to receive this distinction from Republic of Moldova. Thank you very much.
And also the highest award of the Moldova Academy of Sciences, the Medal Dmitry Cantemir, is conferred to the Professor Ionel Miron. Collaborations with the Institute of Zoology and our students, we are hosted for many times in Potoc.
Thank you very much. I wish your conference a great success.
Thank you.
I invite next speakers. Who? Ah, wait, sorry. I invite Bogdan Sinescu.
Good morning. I'd like to thank the organizing committee for inviting this presentation. Now, this presentation is on polymers. And I know mostly we are talking about complexes between low molecular weight compounds. Now, this will be an exception today, but complexes do exist, or higher complexes do exist, if we start from polymers and organic molecules, polymers and inorganic molecules, or polymers and polymers. And my presentation today, my presentation today will be on polymers in supramolecular assemblies intended for bio-related applications. Now, I will have a short introduction and then some arguments of this subject and the role of chemical engineering and polymer science contributions in the field, some challenges and strategies, and then I will discuss very shortly on drug gene delivery systems, on polymer carriers as a solution to these challenges and current challenges and further prospects, some key points, some examples, and I will end with some conclusions. Now, to motivate this field, I will give you just two slides. The first one is not a slide I do really like very much, but it is a very important one. And here I have presented some top 10 medical device technologies between 2009-2014, the investments and the market. The market value was more than $450 billion. And you see here the drug delivery technologies represent $110 billion, and also biomaterials represent about $85 billion. This means it's a very, very important market, and also the interest in this field is extremely, extremely high. And I added there that over half of the nation's health costs is attributed to tissue loss or organ failure. Now, what is also important is that a lot of money are spent every year all over the world in diagnosis. In global, there is about $175 billion. And the annual sales growth of medical systems using biomaterials is of 29% every year. The second slide comes also from Jean-Marie Len. You mentioned him, and it's exactly the same idea. You see, Jean-Marie Len presented this slide in a lecture he gave in last year in Montpellier during a Romanian-France congress on applied chemistry. And again, it's the same idea Professor Duca presented a few minutes ago. Physics is working with, is dealing with the fundamental laws of the universe. Chemistry is the bridge between physics and biology is dealing with the laws of life. So this bridge is important because chemistry is dealing with molecular chemistry, from atoms to molecule, molecules, and we have covalent bonds that are extremely important in this field. And then with supramolecular chemistry, where we are dealing with non-covalent physical bonds, and we are talking about recognition, reactivity, transport, molecular recognition, molecular information, and self-organization, a notion that appeared last 15, 20 years, that yields from fabrication to that directs us from fabrication to self-fabrication processes. Now, the chemical engineering contributions in all this field, it's at the interface between bioengineering and material science. And chemistry helps us understand how materials interact with human body in a bio-oriented field. For instance, understand how different factors affect biocompatibility, which is a very important parameter in all bio-related applications. The chemistry also creates new biomaterials and devices to address unsolved medical problems. And these unsolved medical problems are very, very numerous. For instance, in designing drug or gene control delivery systems, new materials for tissue engineering, materials for minimally invasive surgery, and so on and so on. I could continue for hours in this field. Now, I will use some notions, so I'd like to introduce this notion very shortly. Transfection. Transfection is a process of deliberately introducing nucleic acid into cells just to for biomedical or for medical purposes. The term is often used for non-viral methods in eukaryotic cells. Another important term to be used that is used, for instance, in bio-related applications is gene therapy. And the basic concept here is the following one. Human disease may be treated by the transfer of genetic material into specific cells of a patient in order to enhance gene expression or to inhibit the production of a target protein. The state of the art here nowadays in this field is the following one. Viral vectors to express genes for therapeutic purposes that are used, viral vectors are used as a carriers in this purpose, still show cytotoxicity and immunogenicity or oncogenicity problems. Whereas the in vivo transfection efficiency of non-viral systems, this is synthetic systems, synthetic polymers or natural polymers modified with the introduction of different functional groups, so such systems, non-viral systems, are low in efficiency. And the solution could consist in improving non-viral systems in order to circumvent the body barriers. Now, the non-viral vectors allow the genetic material to pass through cellular barriers, and the functions to consider here are to condense genetic materials and delivery control, to pass through the material through cellular barriers without causing a foreign body immune response, the intracellular trafficking, and release of the genetic material in its active form after separation from the vector. They must ensure such system high gene expression and allow the visualization of the entire process, the following of the entire process into the body till the release of the gene into a cell. Now, the state of the art. Normally we use from the synthetic polymer chemistry cationic polymers with precise design that are able to condense nucleic acids by ionic interactions, thus forming polyplexes. Polyplexes are polymer complexes, in fact. The delivery capacity of such systems is very important. Normally a virus, this is a natural carrier, can load a maximum of about 8 kilobase pairs, while a non-viral vector, this means a synthetic polymer or naturally modified polymer, can load at least 50 kilobase pairs. So it's much more efficient. And there are some other advantages of the non-viral systems, and there are some also limitations, because most of the non-viral vectors exhibit a low transfection efficiency, which should be increased. Now, the scientific challenge in all these fields, the main scientific challenge in all these fields, consists in the design and control of macromolecular materials at different levels of organization, from nano to macro, to achieve a novel functionality. Normally, we need to introduce into one material many functional groups, many functionalities, to obtain very, very complex systems able to fulfill many requirements of the bio-related processes. This is a schematic representation. Normally we start from the design of a system, and then we try to prepare the system to synthesize the components, the building blocks of the system. Then we characterize the whole assembly to see if the properties fit the properties we have followed, we have intended to attend. And then if not, we can start again with modeling, and then the design, and then the synthesis, and so on, and so on. Or, if you want, we are talking about building blocks which have to be very, very well controlled from the point of view of macromolecular weight and functionality and macromolecular weight, polydispersity, and so on. So these building blocks can be low molecular weight compounds or macromolecular compounds with one functionality or two or three or four or multifunctionalities, and then we use old and new building alternatives. This means preparation methods, reactions, different reactions and specific interactions, in order to obtain complex macromolecular architectures through polymerization, cross-linking, self-assembling, self-organization, and so on. And we obtain finally, after a very, very careful control, a complex system. Now, just one example for drug delivery system, materials design, and this is a model proposed about 40 years ago by Professor Helmut Grinsdorf. You see, such a drug delivery system consists of a drug molecule attached with a spacer to a polymeric backbone. Normally this polymeric backbone and the spacer are biodegradable, and the targeting moiety, and also other molecules that are attached for different purposes. This is a quite primitive, but also the first model. And here you see some drug delivery on the right side of the slide. You see some drug delivery systems that consist of macromolecules of different types, linear or cross-linked, or macromolecular systems that contain inside physically bounded drug molecules to in the system. Now this means that under the influence of different external factors, these systems can release the drug from inside the system to outside the system. These are some examples of nanoparticles and liposomes. Nanoparticles here, you see that the many components are to be introduced in such nanoparticles, and everything must be done in a very controlled, very well controlled way. We have here two drug molecules, and we have here targeting and imaging agents, flexible macromolecular chains here, and also some stimuli for the release of the drug from inside the nanoparticles to the human body, ideally. And here it's another system, liposome. Again, protective polymer chains, drugs here, or here, or here, because they can be situated in different places in such a system, and the monoclonal antibody attached to the system. Now, here some contribution of polymer science, and in fact they are quite trivial. Here we have two comonomers. One of them is a functional one, a monomer having groups that are able to that are polar groups and able to attend hydrogen bonding, and then a copolymerization process, we obtain a copolymer, and by using a solvent, by using different external conditions, one can have a particle formations through hydrogen, especially through hydrogen bonds. Now, this particle can collapse and can swell. Imagine that during collapsing, some drug molecules are introduced in the system. So they will be trapped, physically trapped in the system, and when the system will swell, these molecules will be released, so we'll have a sort of drug release from a system which is composed mainly of macromolecular compounds. This is another example. Macromolecular chain containing here isocyanate groups, and then the cross-linking is performed through diamine groups, sorry, and you have a collapse of the system. If you have drug molecules, they are entrapped in such a macromolecular coil, and then by through the swelling of the system you have again the release of drug molecules, and so on. This is practically the same system, and here you see some three block copolymers, A, B, C, and another one. So through self-aggregation they are able to yield such nanoparticles, this one and this one, and then these nanoparticles are able to co-aggregate by simply mixing in appropriate conditions, meaning temperature and solvent, to give such entities, and then self-assembling pattern nanoparticles. So three block copolymers self-assembling in a selected solvent, in selected conditions and controlled conditions, to give higher assemblies and then aggregation into new superstructures. Now here is just, I'm not going into details in this slide and in other slides also, but this is to tell you that normally if we have many functionalities, we have many parameters that we should control. So one way to overcome a lot of experiments is to use simulation techniques and molecular simulation, because that can diminish the number of experiments. And for instance here, for such a particles, nanoparticle, we can control the simulation, the core, we can control the corona, the shell, the interface, and we can control the nanoparticle as a whole, both from the point of view of macroscopic properties and microscopic properties. So this will avoid a lot of experiments in the lab. Now, and just to give you an example of a complex system, here you have cyclodextrins, which are building blocks for supramolecular systems. So they are well known nowadays, and they are known to form inclusion compounds with organic molecules or with macromolecular chains. And here we have used some macromolecular chains, so the system is this one. Being talking only about physical interactions here, so this is a reversible system. We can release the compound that was inside here, the cyclodextrin molecules. And here we have two systems, two macromolecular chains, very complex. All these components are in the table there. And you see that at different pH, values of the pH, you can have such aggregates, and then you change the pH, you are going to different aggregates, and then at the end you trigger, you direct the drugs into the cell in order to control the metabolic processes taking place into the cell. Now here's another system, three block copolymer again, forming micelles of this type, complexes of this type, with DNA molecules, short DNA chains here, in order to form a gel, and then under specific condition the compounds of interest are released, and the DNA molecules, being associated only through physical bonds to the whole assembly, can be released into a cell. Here's another example. We are talking here about, again, cyclotic string guest complexation, and different molecules can be introduced in cyclotic string. In this case, we have some fullerene molecule. Fullerene is a very interesting compound for bio-related applications, and it can be solubilized easier, much easier, in water through the introduction into cyclotic string molecules, which is a hydrophilic molecule. And then, in the second example, we have beta cyclodextrin molecule, and AZT. AZT is a compound which is used in HIV treatments, and but it is an extremely aggressive compound. So to diminish a little bit the aggressivity, but keeping the cytotoxicity, it can be introduced in a cyclodextrin molecule. And the last example, inclusion complex with antifungic activity, is also specific reagent for antifungic purposes introduced in cyclodextrin molecules. Certainly, all these processes, all these systems should be analyzed with specific methods that are currently applied in biochemistry and biology and medicine. Now, this is a summary of what we have done in the laboratory. So, you see that different cores, we have cyclodextrin molecule, C60 molecule, sorry, fullerene molecule, and then polyethylene-imine chains, branched polyethylene, highly branched polyethylene-imine attached to this core, and then we have a C60 and polyethylene glycol and polyethylene-imine, so different systems, and then we have siloxane derivative or octamethyl substituted these four hydrogens, cyclotetrasiloxane molecule as a core, and then modified with allyl glycidyl ether and then with polyethylene imine. Why polyethylene imine? It's a very interesting molecule. If you look at the linear chain of polyethylene imine, it will undergo in solution double helical structures. So it's the only synthetic polymer able to perform double helix structures like DNA. And then the last example, beta cyclodextrin, polyethylene imine, and polyethylene glycol. And here it's a simulation. So you have a DNA molecule, and you have also such compounds able to complex DNA molecules at the beginning of the process, 2 nanoseconds, and then 5 nanoseconds, and then 12 nanoseconds, and 20 nanoseconds. So the carrier is a synthetic polymer. The carried compound is a DNA molecule, short DNA molecule, short DNA fragment. Now, this is a schematic representation again, and also some results from characterization. You see, highly branched polyethylene-imine, slightly modified, attaching through physical bonds DNA segments, and then the analysis of the compound with specific methods for polymer chemistry, electron microscopy, atomic force microscopy, and so on, but also with physical and biological methods of characterization. Now, my younger colleagues have published 3 papers this year in exactly these fields, and you see, they were quite successful, and they appeared on the cover of some journals where they published. Now, this is another example. I'm not going into details here. In fact, here we have gels controlled from the point of view of the structure and the channels they have and the interconnectings of the channels and so on, able to release drugs. So drugs molecules are entrapped in the gels, and then through the deswelling of the gel, drug molecules will be sent outside of the gel. And here you see a lower critical solution temperature, which can be controlled through the ratio between the two components of the block copolymer or scarf copolymers the gels are built from. And here you have in the last figure on the right side of the slide, you see that the answer is very rapid at a temperature we can program from the beginning, because we are interested, if you apply such compounds for the human body, for humans, you need a quick answer at about 37, 38 degrees, a quick release of the drug into the body. This is the structure, the morphology of such thermosensitive gels, composed of a 3-block of polymer, hydroxyethyl methacrylate, and isopropylacrylamide and polyoxazoline. You see the lowest critical solution temperatures, you see the channels of the gel, and you can really control the composition, you can really control the morphology of such gels, and can control through these two parameters the release of the drug. Now, here it's again an example of the rapid swelling rate. You see the swelling rate and the de-swelling the moment the temperature increases, and it's a very rapid response, because normally we need a rapid response, a rapid release of the drug, and in the controlled way. The possible use of such system is for on-off switching materials, as on-off switching materials, and for drug delivery and storage. Another system, you see here, it's also a thermoresponsive system. And you see, this is a pore, the image of a pore, schematic representation of a pore. And in this pore, we have macromolecular chains, which are elongated if the temperature is less than the lower critical temperature, solution temperature. So the drug entrapped in the pore is not released outside the pore. Now, if we increase the temperature, at temperatures higher than the lower critical solution temperature, we have a shrinkage of the macromolecular chain, so the pore will become an open pore and the drug will be released. And then, again, if the temperature is decreased following the release of the drug, we have elongated chains, which mean the drug will no more be released from inside the pore to the outside of the system. And here you have a pulsatile effect on-off, which can be obtained with such systems. Yes, this is only for one purpose, this slide, to show you that and to remember you that in fact every system is very good, but we have to follow that the interior of the cell is about 10 micron diameter. So all systems must be very, very efficient and very small system to be able to penetrate through the membrane and so on to go into the cell. This is repeating hybrid polyethylenamine based non-viral systems. This is a little bit of chemistry, I will not go into details here. So the fullerene molecule modified with polyethylenamine, and here in the lower side of the slide we have polyethylenamine cyclic siloxane conjugated and so on, just to build the system. And here we have some gel electrophoresis and evaluation of the properties, because when attaching DNA molecules, we can estimate exactly from the results and with specific models the ratio between the synthetic polymers, polyethylenamine, and DNA fragments. So how many DNA fragments are attached physically to one polyethylenamine moiety. The same system here. Normally we have to attach some fluorescent molecules just to follow the system and to understand how it penetrates the cell or how is released the DNA into the cell. These are specific methods for biochemists who know very well, and the biologists know very well. Here is another representation for the synthesis of beta-cyclodextrin-based gene delivery systems. And you see in this part what it happens here. And to conclude, macromolecular compounds are key elements and become more and more important in today's medical device developments and technology. Bio-related application of polymer-based materials or polymeric materials are at the interface between chemical engineering, bioengineering, material science. Most of the challenges addressed to scientists are related to the translation of research results from laboratory scale to clinical application. Costs are very, very, very high. We are talking about, well, almost million euros just to introduce in practice from laboratory scale to practice such systems. And to answer to specific biomedical requirements, I didn't discuss in detail all these fields. Further research directions implies a combination of natural and synthetic polymers. Each of them are coming with their advantages and disadvantages. The combination of inorganic and organic materials. The development of combinatorial systems, for instance, gene scaffold, drug implant. Intertwining technologies and the use of modeling and simulation for the appropriate design of materials, systems and technologies. I'd like to thank my colleagues and co-workers, Jetta David, Mariana Pintal, Alexandro Rotaru, Lilia Klima, Cornel Cosocaro, Michela Silion, Gheorghe Funduiano, Marietta Constantin, Cristina Uretu, Andrei Dascalu, the financial support of one grant from the Ministry of Higher Education and Research in Romania, and to thank you all for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for a very good presentation, academician. I think about a question without question, because question during the coffee break. Questions about... Okay. I invite the next speaker, academician Aldoshin, Vice President of Academy of Science of Russia.
Там картинки получаются не очень резкие, не получается.
Good morning, dear colleagues. First of all, I would like to thank our organizing committee for my chance to deliver here my lecture. But I will, my presentation will be devoted to investigation polyfunctional materials, complexes as a new class of NO donors for medicine, which have unusual magnetic and electronic structure and properties. Part of this work has been performed together with Dr. Pali from Institute of Applied Physics, Academy of Sciences of Moldova. My lecture will consist of four parts. But I will say about biological significance of nitric monoxide molecules, specific features of dinitrazyl iron complexes, unusual entangled magnetic properties of dinitrazyl iron complexes with steocarbamide ligands, and quantum entanglement in dimer of dinitrazyl iron complex mu SCN type. Some words about nitric monoxide molecules. This is very simple molecule which consists of only two atoms, and this is gas free radical, has very short lifetime and has very high reactivity. Actually, this is a new type of messenger molecules in living organism. This is significant molecules in various physiological and biochemical processes, integral component of cardiovascular system. These molecules has immune response to pathogens, can participate in control of genetic apparatus, and has very interesting chemical properties. biological value of these molecules depends on concentration in living organism. If the concentration of NO molecules is low, less than 150 nanomole, this molecule exhibits different regulating properties such as vascular permeability, vascular tone, and so on. If concentration of these molecules are high, more than 150 nanomole in living organism, this molecule exhibits protective properties such as cytotoxic protection, anti-tumor activity, antibacterial activity, and so on. If concentration of these molecules are high, more than 1000 nanomole, these molecules exhibit pathological properties such as increased susceptibility, inhibition of mitochondrial breath, and so on. On this slide, different diseases and state of our living organism, which caused by changing of the amount in endogene NO molecules, are presented, such as blood pressure, from blood pressure, bronchial asthma, ischemic heart disease, and cancer. In living organism, there are actually two basic ways of NO formation. This is known enzymatic way, which is connected with the reduction of nitrate and nitrite of NO molecules. And this reaction can occur at different value of pH. Actually, this is inorganic cycle of NO transformation. And there is enzymatic way. This way is performed by ferments, so-called NO synthesis. There are three types of this NO synthesis, and we can obtain NO molecules from L-arginine in living organism in this condition. It is known that NO molecules are accumulated in active site of non-exim proteins, for example, ferdoxime. This you can see structure of active site of this non-exim protein, and NO molecules can modify the structure of this active site, which result in to formation mononuclear dinitrazyl iron complexes. To our investigation, the structure of these complexes are unknown. It was known only that this complex has in EPR spectroscopy special signal with G factor which is equal to 2.03. And these complexes are called complexes with G factor 2.03. And these complexes can very easily release NO groups and after releasing NO groups, the structure, active, structure of active site is reparated and influence L-cysteine and cysteine disulfurase. In our laboratory in Institute of Problem of Chemical Physics in Russia, we managed to obtain different kind of biomimetic models of this active site of non-gene proteins, and we synthesized anionic complexes with different structure, neutral diamagnetic binuclear complexes with short iron-iron distances, and dimeric complexes with long iron-iron distances and mononuclear dinitrazyl iron complexes. And we synthesized in our laboratory cationic dinitrazyl iron complexes. Structural principle for formation of binuclear nitrazyl iron complexes and mononuclear nitrazyl iron complexes is very simple. Main structural units of these complexes is dinitrazyl iron. And due to this nitrazyl iron unit can be linked through bidentate or tridentate bridges of bivalent sulfur atoms. And we can obtain different type of these complexes. Simultaneously, we use different functional S ligand to obtain multifunctional compounds with multifunctional properties. We used S ligands which are inhibitors for growth of various tumors, which anti-inflammatory and antibacterial agent and neutral tools to obtain our complexes with multifunctional properties. We managed to obtain very good NO donors, and we could compare NO donor ability of our complexes to in comparison with commercial so-called NONO8 diethylene-3-MI. And we conclude that complexes which have been obtained in our laboratory are very good and promising NO donors. We performed study of cardiotropic activity of water-soluble nitrazyl ion complexes using the model of ischemic and reperfusion damage of myocardium in vitro and in vivo. And we carried out investigation in donors, donor activity to find approaches to obtain non-platinum chemotherapeutical drugs. We found that properties of these complexes depend on concentration of NO molecules in our living organism, and NO molecules can induce tumor progression or tumor regression. On this slide, we demonstrate the results of investigation in vivo for different complexes with different structure and with different ligands. At present, we perform a preclinical investigation on dinitrazyl iron complexes with cysteine-amine ligand. Here we would like to show best NO donors for therapy of acute coronary heart disease. This is two complexes, a complex with penicillamine ligand and complex with thiosulfate ligand, and complex for anti-tumor therapy with cysteine-amine ligand. And on this table, we would like to summarize results of our investigation. We obtained different NO donors with different physiological activities, which are promising to development different drug materials. Now I would like to say some words about specific features of dinitrazyl iron complexes. In spite of geometrical structure of these complexes are very simple, these complexes have very unusual electronic structure due to readiness direct and reverse negative attraction between the orbitals of iron center with p star orbitals of NO group. Due to direct dative interaction from the orbitals of iron center into p-star orbitals of NO group, NO ligands can be realized as nitroxyl anion state with minus charge. And oxidation state for this electronic state is plus 3, and this unit has one unpaired electron. Due to reverse dative direction from P star orbitals of NO group into the orbitals of iron center, oxidation state of iron is minus 1, and this unit has one unpaired electron. But when there is no negative interaction between the orbitals of iron center and NO orbitals, P star orbitals of NO group, oxidation state rate of iron center is plus one, and this electronic structure can be in high spin state with 5 unpaired electron, and low spin state with 3 unpaired electron. To investigate details of structure of this unit, we carried out precision X-ray investigation of mononuclear complex, and we found that charge on NO group is very small, only minus 0.3, and this charge is close to charge on sulfur atom, and we can conclude that NO ligand, NO group in these complexes is realized in radical neutral form. On the basis of magnetic investigation of these complexes, we can conclude that dinitrazyl iron center has only one unpaired electron, and on the basis of this investigation, we can conclude that two p electrons, unpaired electrons on NO group, are coupled with two or of three unpaired d electrons of an iron center. We performed one quantum chemical investigation of these complexes, mononuclear complexes, and binuclear dimer complex mu S type and mu N S C type. And we found that dinitrazyl iron center has only one unpaired electron. And then we can conclude that this phenomenon is connected with pairing of opposite-oriented spins of NO group and unpaired electron which are located on iron center. And iron NO bond has a homeopolar structure. And on the basis of this investigation, we concluded that singlet state with broken symmetry is lower than triplet state. And these complexes, mononuclear complexes and binuclear complexes, mu and CS type, are paramagnetic, and complex of mu S type is diamagnetic due to very short distances between iron centers. We found that properties depends on crystal structure of this compound. And we found that NO-NO interaction play essential role and can influence crystal packing and properties of these compounds. We found that these compounds have packing type A or packing type B. Packing type A have very shortened contacts between NO-NO groups, and in packing type B there is no shortened NO-NO contact. We investigated different complexes with geocarbamide ions and with different anions, and we found that complex 1 has packing type A, and complex 2 and 4 have packing type B. And these complexes have very different magnetic properties. Complexes 3 has intermediate structure between packing tape A and packing tape B. And we found that complexes 2 and 4, which have packing type B, show properties that are magnetic properties that are different from expected 1. We couldn't explain these results, and we considered the structure of free NO molecules. It is known that free NO molecules has an axial symmetry. And 2p triplet is separated into excited term and ground p term. Ground p term is degenerated with respect to projects plus one and minus one of angular orbital moment, which is equal one. But due to this phenomena, the orbital moment is not completely quenched. Our orbital moment is not completely quenched and can contribute to general magnetic moment. But it is known that coordination of NO group with iron is accompanied by quenching of orbital moment due to loss symmetry and intermolecule interaction. Here you can see Hamiltonians which describe this situation. Splitting triplet into excited singlet and degenerated ground terms is shown here and can be described by this Hamiltonian with splitting parameters between excited state and ground state delta E axial symmetry. But under influence of crystal field, B duplet is separated and this parameter splitting delta R. And this Hamiltonian describes this phenomenon. Here you can see spin orbital interaction on NO group lambda. This is parameter of spin orbital interaction and K. This is factor of orbital reduction. And Zeeman interaction for NO group, which tries to mix excited terms with ground P terms. And if the parameter delta R rhombic splitting is small, we have contribution non-completely quenched orbital moment into electronic moment of on NO group. On the basis of this approach, we succeeded to describe experimental results for these complexes and using reasonable value three parameter, splitting parameter, rhombic splitting parameter, axial splitting parameter, and orbital interaction. We can conclude that structural data points to possibility to existence of non-quenched orbital moments on nitrosyl groups due to incomplete splitting of ground terms of these groups and their Zeeman mixing. And by varying the above parameter in reasonable range for each structure, we can describe magnetic properties of these compounds. But these compounds has additional very unusual properties, so-called quantum entanglement in dimer complexes. You can see here dimeric complexes NCS type. You can see here temperature dependence of magnetic moment and temperature dependence of susceptibility and structure of these complexes. Actually, this is Heisenberg dimer structure with two paramagnetic center which has one unpaired electron on each center. Specific features of this structure. There is no shortened intermolecular contacts, and intermolecular iron-iron contacts exceed 5 angstrom, but intramolecular iron-iron contacts are about 4 angstrom. And therefore, this structure is typical Heisenberg dimer with anti-ferromagnetic intramolecular interaction. But at zero temperature, singlet state of this dimer is described by wave function 1. This function 1 has very interesting properties. This is entangled quantum state. What means entangled? It means that given state of the system psi does not define uniquely the state of subsystem. But if state of one subsystem is defined, a state of another one is defined uniquely. And actually, this quantum state describes a coherent superposition of two qubits of information. And we have actually the register of quantum computer. And we can conclude that these complexes mu SCN type can have quantum correlation, which is very promising for development new quantum devices. It's very difficult to determine entanglement in these complexes, but Hill and Waters have defined the value of this entanglement via so-called concurrence. Concurrence C. Concurrence, this is product of two functions, a psi function and orthogonal psi function, and can be described from coefficient of basic function. But it's very important that concurrence C is connected with magnetic interaction in complexes. And it's very simple to show that in dimer with ferromagnetic exchange interaction and zero temperature entanglement and concurrence has zero value. But in dimer with antiferromagnetic exchange interaction and zero temperature entanglement and concurrence have maximal value, which is equal to 1. But upon the growth entanglement in dimer decreases, and there is temperature when entanglement disappears completely. This temperature is temperature of arising entanglement in complexes. We found that we can find correlation between magnetic susceptibility in these complexes and with temperature at which entanglement arises. And it's necessary to say that entanglement has fluctuation. And there is temperature when fluctuation and value of entanglement is equal. We managed to obtain the temperature at which entanglement arises. For these complexes with imidazole-2-ill ligand, we found that entanglement in these complexes arises at temperature below 80-90 degrees. It's very good temperature to develop quantum devices. For complexes with imidazole-2-ill ligand with this structure, we found that for these complexes entanglement arises at temperature below 110 or 120 degrees. But here you can see temperature dependence of concurrence and entanglement for these complexes. And we found that at temperature 38, entanglement fluctuation becomes equal to the entanglement. And we can conclude that for dimeric binuclear complex with this structure, entanglement sufficient for the application as materials for quantum computer is achieved about temperature 40 degrees. Some requirements to quantum correlation for creation and the quantum devices. First of all, the presence of entanglement of quantum state in our system at rather high temperature. We have to have inconsiderable fluctuation. We have to obtain compounds with long time of quantum decoherence. I mean spin lattice relaxation, direction of spin with ligands. And general conclusion. In our investigation, we managed to obtain very good NO donors, which are promising for drug, for medicine. And we found that basic structure of these complexes is dinitrazyl iron unit, is paramagnetic and has 1 ampere electron. The structural data point to the possibility of existence of non-completely quenched orbital moment on this nitrazyl group due to incomplete splitting the ground terms of this group and the Zeeman mixing with excited state. In spite of short iron-iron distances in dinitrazyl iron complexes with antiferromagnetic exchange interaction, this union has residual magnetic moment in this residual magnetic moment is connected with incompletely splitting orbital moment on NO group. And nitrazyl iron complexes mu SCN type are very promising for development new devices with quantum chemical correlation. And now I would like to thank my colleagues which took part in this investigation. thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Antoshin, for your very, very interesting presentation. Now, the next lecture will be given by Professor Gula, Aurelian Gula, from the Academy of Sciences of Norway.
Thank you.
Participants of our conference. First of all, I would like to say welcome to all participants, and I would say very many thanks to the all persons who are activated this conference as invited lecturers, as plenary lectures, and I will mention here the presence of many young people, the PhD students, the master students, and recent students from Moldova State University and from the academic university. I think that this beginning is very useful for the young people that are present. Our conference, as Professor Duca mentioned, is dedicated to the memory of Constantin Turta, Professor, and Professor Mikhail Revienko. During the years, these two scientists have a very big effort to the organizing of this conference, but the history is the first All-Union Conference was organized in 1962 by academician Antonio Ablov, and the topic was application of physical methods in coordination chemistry. And the first organizing committee included the well-known scientists from Russia, Poland, for example, academician Gribing from Pittsburgh University, academician Chernyayev from Kornakov Institute, academician Belov, Malinovsky, and Professor Panijewska-Shebetowska from Poland. During the years, this conference was developed and the topics was changed, not so essentially, but for example, in 1971, the conference was application of methods, modern methods in coordination chemistry. And after this, by academician Bersukir, the name of conference was Physical and Mathematical Methods in Coordination Chemistry. On time, our conference was in Novosibirsk in 1987, and the co-organizer of the conference were many times the Institute Kornakov and Moldova State University, also another physical institute, applied physics. And during the years, the Professor Garbalov and Professor Turta will continue this conference. And since 2000, the conference have the actual topics, the application of coordination methods, the methods in coordination and supramolecular chemistry. One of the organizers of this conference was Professor Evenko. Professor Evenko was graduated from Moldova State University. He became a doctor here and a habilitated doctor in Odessa and vice rector of our university. And in the same time, he was the head of an organic chemistry department and coordination chemistry at the Institute of Chemistry of Moldova, and the head of laboratory of analytical chemistry also in the Institute of Chemistry. During his scientific life, he was very productive, many scientific publications, 375 publications, 6 patents, 4 general articles and books. He was a very good international cooperation in different projects, CINTAS, NATO, CIRDF, MERDRA. Good cooperation with France, Professor Clairac, for example. And his activity was, scientific activity was dedicated to the activation of chemical agents by coordination and the synthesis of new materials as biological active substances, catalysts, analytical reactives, and molecular magnets. Investigations of Professor Evenko were dedicated on study of changes in TOCM composite fragment under the coordination of the complex generator. The starting point of such investigations were 3 types of transformations in TOCM composite fragment we know as condensation of amine group of carbonylic derivatives and information of formation of TOCM carbazone, cyclization with alpha-diceton and formation of heterocyclic compounds, and thioalkylation and alkyl halogenur, the impact of coordination under the each atom of TOCM carbazotic fragment was investigated, and for the first time those results were implemented for obtaining of new materials with the bacterial properties, the catalysts, analytical agents, molecular magnetic, etc. For the nitrogen position one, found a monoelectronic redox reaction, the formation of anion radicals and its stabilization as ligands in coordination compounds. Selective oxidation of radicals and formation of B electron oxidation products. In position 2, nitrogen 2, and found the amplification of the acid properties of amine group during coordination and by variation of substitution in position 4. Intermolecular coordination of nitrogen 2, the formation of polymers and the amino aminic automerization for TO alkyl derivatives. Position of sulfur and carbon, change of coordination mode after thioalkylation and oxidative dimerization with disulfuric bonds formation. For the carbon free, reaction of total desulfurization, reaction of re-etherification and formation of alkoxy derivatives. For the nitrogen position 4, appearance of acid properties of N4H2 group and the deprotonation after coordination. Reaction of amido neutralization, reaction of nucleophilic addition and formation of symmetric and asymmetric amine. Amplification of photolytic properties under the coordination effects. Reaction of esterification, reaction of condensation, and the reaction of oxidative amidation. Most of publications, the last publications, they are dedicated also to the template synthesis and the collaboration with Professor Professor Clerac and PhD students, was the synthesis of new ligands, the new tetradentate ligands, two bases. One of them is a direct interaction between the S-alkyl thiosemicarbazone with aldehyde, formation of different types of ligands, and after this, very interesting interactions in presence of metal with the possibility to form the tetradentate coordination with metal and to obtain the very large gamma of the ligands and the complexes. For example, the complexes with nickel and on the matrix of nickel and kappa, obtaining asymmetric carbonyl agents. In the case of nickel, so you have monomeric layers, structure, but in case of kappa, you have dimeric. And another most interesting the complexes is manganese, where the number of coordinated atoms in the cluster are or 6 or this, or 10 the number of atoms, central atoms, bridged by mu oxo and mu ethoxo fragments. Here you have a very interesting complex with 10 atoms of manganese, and some investigations of magnetic properties of such type of complexes, odonaric, which don't the possibility of formation of dimerization and sulfur-sulfur bonds. And magnetic properties show that this type of magnetism is low single magnet molecules properties. Another types of investigations by the PhD doctor Seku, dedicated to formation also the magnetic materials in base of salicylidene as alkyl thiosemicarbazide. And in this case, we have a formation of interaction between two parts of manganese complexes. Via the linking, and the linking is between two parts is during the is complexes with interaction this complex of manganese with linking by metallic complexes cyanide of iron, osmium, ruthenium. And it's very interesting, this type of interaction results the linear trimeric complexes, and with interesting magnetic properties. If you have see here the interaction, the barrier is 19.2 for iron complexes and 21.3 for ruthenium, 25.4 for osmium. This type of magnets or single molecule magnets are good. And for the preliminary conclusions that this type of complexes the behavior as a single magnetic molecule is good, and the perspective of formation of this type of single magnetic molecules have the perspective. Another applications of Professor Evenko, the construction of ion selective electrodes. This type of electrodes are based on the 4 or 3 neoxo chromium complexes. This on the possibility for using trinuclear chromium bivalats as new electroactive materials for potentiometric sensor. And we are created by PhD Dr. Mariana Duru, 17 sensors and with different apical ligands and an ion external sphere. This type of complexes have the application for determining the perchlorates for monitoring the presence of perchlorate in anion cation, and nitrate complexes with very interesting for Moldova, for example, for determining nitrate ions in nitric ions in tree and vegetables. Also, the quantitative determination of salicylate in alcoholic solutions, determinations of silver ions, and in determination of anionic anionic surfactant in shampoo and detergent and dish gel, and also Renat, Perrenat ions. Also, the determination of the end point integration of sodium tetraphenylboride. In the equipe of collaborator of Professor Evenko, we are the young people as Palomar Chukuleg, Dr. Gulmaga, PhD Dr. Seku, Sirbo Angela, and Dr. Palomar Chukatiana, and also Lena and Mariana Duru, with the a very active collaborator, young collaborator, as the collaborative of Moldova State University. Here, in the photo, ancient photo from 2005, Professor Denko with Professor Andruh Marius in Chisinau. Also, Chugayeva Congress in 2009 in Suzdali, Russia, Professor Evenko, the equipe from Moldova, and the Professor Bersuker, who was present at this conference. The second part of my communication is dedicated to the compounds with strong anti-cancer activity. About 60 organic molecules and their coordination compounds have been investigated. So the type of molecules is shown here as derivatives of tiosemicarbazone, tiosemicarbazid, the continuation of type of molecules have been studied by Professor Evenko. Here we have 4 levels of diversity. The diversity of the 4 position, Z position, oxygen, sulfur, selenium, nitrogen, and 3 radicals, position R1, R2, R3, no possibility the is this possible to form 3 types of level diversity in this type of organic molecules. These investigations were consecrated to the study of antiproliferative activity of this type of molecules, and For example, we have the cancer cells and the investigations leukemia, HL60, DK562, prostate cancer, NGRAF, and breast cancer, MCF7, T47D, liver cancer, melanoma cancer, cervical cancer. For example, I see the analysis of the first level of diversity for the leukemia cell anti-proliferative activity, optimization in positions that the first level of diversity. We have that activity change very essentially from oxygen to sulfur. The IC50 inhibitory concentrations of T50 consist for oxygen derivatives 450 micromolar, for nitrogen 85, and for sulfur 9 micromolar molarity. This the best. The best is the sulfur, and we have used this composition containing sulfur for develop different type of anti-proliferative agents. So the optimization on position R2, the second level of diversity, we have the activity is increased from 800 till 0.1 micromolar. The most important here, one can see, is the molecules with pyridine, containing pyridine as a radical, and for this type of combination, we have a very good activity at one molar activity, and for the second and the third level of diversity, when we change the optimization of position R1 by hydrogen, methyl, and benzene radicals, phenolic radicals, one can see that the activity, anti-cancer activity, is very considerable from these radicals, and we have the concentration IC50, molarity is nano molarity, it's very good activity. And the last one is the optimization of the fed position, fourth level of diversity. Here we have really very good anti-proliferative action of different position 4, Pimetox group, Ineta, Para, Orto. The variation of this activity is from 9.9 till 3.7 nanomolarity, so that it is very important for this kind of molecules. And another radicals in the position of meta position, for example, iodine, methyl, and bromine, don't also is very important. The same, but the activity is not so good. Another type of interactions with metallic ions was the formation of many complexes with cobalt 2, cobalt 3, copper, nickel, manganese, zinc, ferrum, and gallium complexes. These metallic complexes are geometrical electronic structures and thermodynamic and thermal stabilities. One can see that this activity change for difference from ligand to the complexes, and the variety of complexes instigated from monomeric, dimeric, trimeric, and polymeric, and also to different heterometallic complexes. It can see the activity of organic molecules, of organic ligand and coordinated ligand. One can see that the activity as a rule increase with introducing the metal in the coordination. For example, here we have the molecule, organic molecules, alkyl, pyridine, TO semicarbazone, and the activity 0.12 micromolar, but for the complex is 0.010 micromolar. So it's very good increasing of the antiproliferative activity by introducing metal in the formation of complexes, and the activity of complexes as a rule is better than for the ligands. The nature of metal complexes, so the metal as a generator of complexes, for example, copper, cobalt, and ferrum, is demonstrated that we have the nature of the metal is also important. But the very important is the initial ligand. It is recommended to have, first of all, an organic molecule. You had good activity, and after this, the activity will be better in the presence of the metal, formation metal complexes. In this table, we can see that the organic molecules are very active for different type of cancer cells activity. But for example, for prostate cancer, this activity is zero. There are not activity. But by introducing the metal in these complexes, one can see that this type of molecules are active and for prostate cancer also. We have tried to set the activity for normal cells and also in parallel the inhibition of cancer cells. It's very important to the line, but this rate is good, and we have 15 or 12 or 10 or 22. It indicates that this type of complexes kill the molecules, the cells of cancer, and they are not very active for the normal cells. If you have the mechanism of the action of complexes, it is well known that platinum is have a kinetic mechanism inhibition, the time life of these complexes and the time of multiplication or replication of DNA is the same. And this time is necessary to form the bonding with platinum in the position 7. Another mechanism proposed in Canada, for example, is the formation of hydrogen bonds. And we use this for explication of activity of a type of molecules, the TO semicarbazone, for example, by the formation of weak hydrogen bonds for stopping the development or the multiplications of cancer cells. One of the most illustration you see here, we have Rembrandt, the hydrogen in position alpha. We have the activity, good activity of hydrogen, but if we have this substituent bromine or ethyl, the activity dramatically changed and disappeared. For the comparison of this type of action of hydrogen formation, we have used the X-ray information and the surface charge, electrostatic surface charge, to compare their activity. And we can see that if for normal pyridine this activity 0.12 micromolar, and for very negative position of nitrogen atom, when we change the position of nitrogen, the activity dramatically is changed, and also changed the charge of this pyridine atom. We have this correlation is good also with the nitrogen NMR investigations. The chemical shifts for molecules which have good activity is in the high field. And the correlation is that when the charge is negative for pyridinic atom, we have increased the anti-cancer activity. So from hydrogen, from methyl and the phenyl groups, the activity increased considerably. And to finish, conclusions, finally it should be mentioned that some of the new compounds possessing chemical and biological properties related to those of cisplatin might be very active but short weakening for binding at all of DNA. Lots of the other metal compounds may be shown to be active in cancer treatment and primary interact with the biological targets. As summarizing and illustrated above, the design and development of DNA binding metal containing drugs requires detailed coordination chemistry knowledge of metal DNA binding processes regarding structure, thermodynamics, and kinetics. During the last decade, we have been giving attention to new approaches like bifunctionality. This approach has started with attention to hydrogen bonding as a secondary interaction and has developed towards attached intercalators attached to drugs and the second of that metal, all with a major aim to avoid resistance development or synthesis of tumor specific drugs. And finally, also underdeveloped but less directly related of DNA binding is the control of the toxic side effects, development of the coordination chemistry of compounds with risk and protective agents. And more directly related to DNA binding of metal compounds is the migration of complexes along the DNA chain. And I will say my thanks to Professor Donald Poirier. Most of the investigations were carried out. Also, I say my thanks for Professor Gudumac from Moldova State University of Medicine and Pharmacy, Testimitsanu, and Professor Andrzej Lipkowski from Poland. I think also my collaborators, Sanovitsky, Berkat, Zatkov, Paladi, Volimestru, and equipe of young PhD and master students. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Professor, for a very interesting presentation about your work and the achievements of Professor Mikhail Ivenko. Thank you very much. And now we finish the first session. First of all, I invite all participants of the conference in front of the Academy of Science for family picture.
And second, after that, I invite coffee break and the yellow blue. We begin second session in 11:30. I invite you in this hall.
welcome to this second session. We're going to kick off with a talk on MOFs, the cycling heat transformation process, by Christoph Janiak.
Yeah, welcome everybody. I hope you had a good coffee break. As you just heard, my talk will be on a special kind of materials, which is called metal organic frameworks for cycling heat transformation processes. So the background of my talk is about conditioning of air in rooms. So you know very well that in many parts of the world, you can only live and work comfortably if you have some kind of air conditioning. So nowadays, there is a number given here that in modern buildings, about 50% of the energy consumption or energy going into a modern building is for air conditioning, which could be cooling in the summer, heating in the winter. So in the center here, you have a typical residential building in a typical small 10 million city in China. So each rectangle you see here, drawn by me, encircles one or two conventional air conditioners. That is just one side of a building. There are three others, and this is just one building in a city which has about thousands of these buildings for 10 million people. So now you know that electricity to run these conventional air conditioners comes from burning fossil fuels mainly. You know very well that electricity is the most valuable form of energy. For 1 kilowatt hour of electricity, you have to put in 3 kilowatt hours of fossil fuels equivalents. And I give you another value here on the next slide. So this section here is the southeastern part of the United States, from Texas to North Carolina. In this small section of the world, with comparatively few people living there, the electricity consumption from 1993, just running conventional air conditioners, has increased from 90 terawatt hours to 129 terawatt hours to the year 2009. So there is an increase by 43%, and by now, so 2009, one fifth of the whole electricity consumed in this small section of the world is 21% for to run the air conditioners. So maybe we should do something about it, namely perhaps getting to other types of means to get a room climate without using so much electricity. How can that be done? So that is where now the MOFs come in as a new class of porous materials. So you know very well that there are roughly three classes of porous materials: the inorganic zeolites and silica gel. And as a normal consumer, you have seen these desiccant packs of silica gel. There is organic forms like active carbon and now covalent organic frameworks, depicted here, and in between you have inorganic organic hybrids. So for example, metal organic frameworks is one of them. So what is different or typical for metal organic frameworks? They have defined identical pores, they have designable properties. So that sets them apart from the other classes which I have depicted. In addition, the metal organic frameworks have a much higher surface area. So for the inorganic zeolite silica gel and the organic active carbon, you have roughly 1,000 square meters per gram as an upper value, and the MOFs have between 2,000 and 4,000 square meters per gram, which can be obtained. These are not record values, there are much higher values possible. However, the record values shouldn't be taken too seriously, because often MOFs which have 5,000, 6,000 or 7,000 square meters per gram don't really survive even a nitrogen sorption isoform. So I've depicted here what 4,000 square meters per gram rather means. So half a soccer field is about a little bit less than 4,000 square meters per gram. So MOFs are constructed from organic linkers. I have depicted three prototypical linkers here: the benzene-1,3,5-dicarboxylate, the benzene-1,4-dicarboxylate, and methyl imidazolate. So in addition, you need metal, and most often these come as secondary building units, having some small clusters, a dicarbon unit here, or a trichromium unit, and more rare are single metal atoms functioning as that's the nodes. So from these, the organic linkers and the metal building units, you then construct or can construct porous three-dimensional networks, and three examples are depicted down here. They will be noted later on in my presentation, briefly at least. So the first one here is abbreviated as HCRUST1, standing for Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. The second one is MIL101, Materials Institute Lavoisier. And the third one is ZIF8, which stands for Zeolitic Imidazolate Frameworks. So MOFS is a very dynamic field. So shown here is the number of publications per year up to now. And you realize that metal organic frameworks and its brother in a way, coordination polymers, accounts for several thousand publications per year, still rising. So a lot of people work in the area of MOFS, obviously. And most of them do so because MOFS have this very fascinating porosity. So around this porosity are centered then application-oriented properties such as add and desorption of gases, gas storage, gas separation, pollutant sequestration, drug storage, drug delivery. We will talk today about other possibilities of drug delivery, luminescence, magnetism, which features also important in this conference here, spin crossover, which you will hear more about, and other materials, microelectronics, all the way until catalysis. So what we are after is water sorption for heat transformation, and we came across this aspect of water sorption by having discovered accidentally a MOF constructed from these two linkers here, which was synthesized from water, and thereby it contained a large amount of water of crystallization, you could say. So down up here is depicted the empty MOF with the water of crystallization depleted artificially, and down here you see the MOF with the water of crystallization shown as in space filling mode. So we also showed that the water from these pores here can be removed and brought back in, and this could be done over 10 cycles, of which 4 are depicted here, within these boundary conditions of temperature and water pressure, water partial pressure. So we have no loss of water uptake capacity. So if you are aware to some extent of the interest in MOFs, you certainly know that most people go after hydrogen storage, carbon dioxide sequestration, or maybe methane storage. But why water, or why would water be interesting in some porous material anyway? So I give you an important example on the next slide. So you see here, what you see here is a beer keg. So most people certainly would agree that a beer tastes good only if it's cold. The British don't, I know that by now. They like warm beer also, but in most parts of the world, people like a cold beer. So how can you get a cold beer if you don't have the keg, which you see here, pre-refrigerated, or you don't have a refrigerator which can cool the keg, or you don't have ice which could cool the keg? So let's say you're in the in the countryside, you don't have anything else but a typical keg or a keg like this. So this keg is special, that's why it's also called a cool keg, because it can cool itself. How does it do that? That is shown here. So the keg has a double-walled barrel construction. That's no gimmick, it's really commercially available. So inside is of course a beer, then comes a small layer of thin layer of water here, separated initially with a valve from a layer of activated empty zeolite. So you can open this valve here, which separates the two layers, with the valve opener on top. And you know what zeolite does? If it can adsorb water, it does so very quickly also. So this, in order to adsorb the water is driven to evaporation by the empty zeolite. And when water evaporates, it has to draw heat of evaporation from its environment. The environment of the water is the beer, and whereby it cools the beer. And after a few minutes, opening the valve, you can then get a cold beer. So this really works. I have been told, well, I have convinced myself by talking to people who have used this keg. Of course, there is a heavy deposit on the keg, so it's supposed to be returned to the brewery to be recycled. So in a more scientific approach, I show you the same process here in this more chemistry setup, a water-filled vessel separated with a valve from an active sorbent material. So when you open the valve here, the whole setting is under a slight vacuum because the vapor pressure of water under normal pressure is not too high. So, and this infrared picture shows you what then happens in terms of change in temperature. So the water-filled vessel gets cold within a few minutes, down to -5 degrees centigrade, the formation of ice. And this vessel here gets hot because the heat of adsorption is dissipated, so up to 45 degrees centigrade. So that means, or shows you, that adsorption material can generate cold by driving water to evaporation, and also it generates heat. So you can use this process here, or if you can turn it around, to generate cold as a new type of air conditioner, or heat for heat pumping mode. So, and such type of generating useful cold needs much less electricity, about 1/3 only, than the typical compressor air conditioners, which I showed to you in the very beginning. Of course, to make such a process feasible, you have to regenerate the adsorption material, so to turn the process around. And the whole setup in a more engineering type picture is then given here. So what you have just seen in the infrared picture was the working cycle. So heat is drawn from the environment to evaporate the working fluid, mostly water, and the adsorption material then takes up the water, giving off heat of adsorption. So whereby you get useful cold or useful heat, depending if you want to use it as adsorption chiller or adsorption heat pump. Then it comes to the regeneration cycle. You have to bring in heat to desorb the working fluid from the adsorption material, which can be will be recondensed then, so that it's available for the next cycle. So these two cycles can be turned around within 5 to 10 minute intervals. And of course, it would be most attractive to have the heat, which you need here as driving heat, generated by solar thermal heating. Irrespective of where the heat comes from, the whole setup needs much less electricity. The electricity is mainly needed to pump the fluids. That means to bring the cold as heat exchangers to the rooms of a building, or to dissipate here the heat of adsorption, which is given off to the environment. So that may sound to you a little bit fantastic, but the next picture shows that devices running on adsorption chilling using silica gel or zeolite are already commercially available. So shown here are two tabletop devices, you could say, from two companies with web pages, which manufacture such adsorption chillers for single family homes, for example. So you see the two chambers here, this one being in the regeneration cycle, so heat has to be given to this for regeneration. This chamber here is in the working cycle, drawing the working fluid, which then gives the useful cold. And down here you see that it's not a one-time thing by just two companies. I've listed here several companies in several countries which manufacture such adsorption chillers in different types of capacities, from 50 to 1000 kilowatts or smaller devices. So it's certainly a technology which is mature, and the next picture shows also that now the colleagues which we collaborate with, they already investigate the possibility to combine such a device on a larger scale, 70 kilowatts, with a solar thermal collector field on the roof of a building to support the regeneration by solar thermal heating. At present, the heat to regenerate the material, the adsorption material, mainly comes from waste heat, for example, from gas burners. So now you may think, okay, we have a mature technology, but why do I give a lecture then here on MOFs, or what do MOFs have to do with that technology? Because you saw that, as I already told you, silica gel and zeolites can do the job. Now, silica gel and zeolites certainly work. However, the water uptake capacity, or water loading lift, which is given here as a Y scale, of silica gel or zeolite is comparatively low on a gram-to-gram basis. So about 0.1 gram gram per gram for silica gel, 0.3 or 0.2. 5 gram for zeolite. So moths, however, because of their much higher surface area, can take up 4 to 5 times the amount of the classical inorganic sorbent materials. So moths would allow to run this whole process much more economical and also much faster. You would be able to turn around the process more frequently. So especially the next, the moth shown here, namely MIL-101 chromium, is the moth which has this high uptake capacity depicted in the previous transparency. Of course, this is a moth not synthesized by me, but coming from a group of Ferret in France. And it is special in a way because it's very stable from coordination chemistry principle. It's chromium free, so it is inert, kinetically inert, and it has a surface area of 4,000 square meters per gram, which can be quite easily achieved. And this morph has the uptake capacity of water in its own weight, so it can take more than 1 gram of water per gram of morph material. Certainly, you don't want to do it only once, so we have to show, and that's what we did, that in a hydrothermal stress test, that there is no loss of uptake capacity over a certain number of cycles. So we did that. So shown here is that the water uptake does not diminish over 40 cycles, and also the BET surface area stays the same within experimental error. Certainly 40 cycles is not too much if you estimate that a lifetime of such an adsorption chiller device of 10 years has about 250,000 cycles that the material would have to last. Certainly we have to do more investigations here, but one thing already is seen, which is has also to be improved, and that is a job for a chemist, because the uptake pressure is at 0.4 relative pressure of water. So this is not bad, but it's still a little bit too hydrophobic. The engineers say that the best well region would be between 0.2 0.3. We set out then to try to make this material more hydrophilic. How can you do that? Now you try to bring in groups on these aromatic linkers, which could function as hydrogen bond acceptors or donors or both. So you can easily, because the material is very stable, post-synthetically functionalize this MOF. We're using concentrated nitrating acid, and then followed by a reduction here, and the whole morph survives, so you can fully functionalize each linker or just partially functionalize a certain percentage of these linkers. So we expected that this would be helpful and make the material more hydrophilic, but somewhat to our surprise, we had to realize that most of the water uptake still occurs around 0.4, and also only the amine functionalization kept water uptake capacity of about 1 gram per gram of material, while the nitro functionalization lost the uptake capacity. So the nitro materials were much less hydrophilic even. So we had to look for other MOFs, and that was, for example, in the titanium series or the zirconium MOFs. I give names here, MIL-125, which is a titanium MOF, which can also be aminofunctionalized, and the zirconium MOF, UIO-66. These MOFs are considered to be very stable also, and we tested them. Indeed, both MOFs are more hydrophilic. So you see here, by looking at the water uptake curves, that especially the amino MIL-125 shows the water uptake even below 0.2 relative pressure. So a shift of the uptake curve towards the left indicates increasing hydrophilicity. So this is here the hydrothermal stress test for the amino MIL-125, and you see the blue curve is what you have to look at. There is just a very small loss of uptake capacity, but such a loss is nothing to worry about, because even silica gel would show a similar loss over the first 40, 50, 100 cycles or so. So there is still of some breaking in of a material. So, of course, the uptake capacity is not really so high anymore, even though 0.3 gram per gram would still be commercially feasible. But we try to look for materials which have a higher uptake capacity. So luckily, the group of Ferret has synthesized a lot of MILs, including also compounds called MIL-100, which are based on iron, aluminum, and also chromium. And among them, the MIL-100 iron has, again, a much higher uptake capacity of 0.75 gram per gram, which also falls to a considerable extent into a region which is below 0.4, so around 0.3 relative pressure already. And from the uptake, the hydrothermal stress test, you again see there is little small loss only, so the BT surface area over 40 cycles does not diminish. Now, we are only chemists, so we can do some things. However, if you have to collaborate with engineers, they tell you you have to do more than just giving us new compounds, because the compounds you give us, we get as microcrystalline powders, which is nice, but no good if you want to incorporate such microcrystalline powders in these adsorption chilling devices, which really could be sold. Because what they want is that these materials are put on the surface of the heat exchanger pipe. You have seen in this engineering type layout that there are heat exchangers going through the working fluid, which is no problem because it's a liquid contact here, but also there's a heat exchanger going through this adsorption material. Now, if you want to have fast heat dissipation, because then the whole process is only feasible, so you cannot have the glass flask, which I showed you in the beginning in this infrared picture, the heat dissipation from a glass flask would be much too slow. So, but the whole process only works efficiently if you have fast dissipation. So you have to remove the heat which is generated here as heat of adsorption as fast as possible. And when you regenerate, you have to bring in the driving heat as fast as possible to the MOF material. So that could be done efficiently only if the MOF is a thin layer on such a real-world heat exchanger pipe. So what you see here is a thin coil heat exchanger, 10 centimeter in diameter of this pipe, and what you see is a blue color is a MOF, namely the H-crust 1. So with H-crust 1 is more shown here for demonstration principle. It's not so feasible because it's not so water stable if you would work with water as a working fluid. So how can you coat a metal with a MOF, you may wonder if you are familiar with working with MOFs. Now you have of course to design a synthesis route which generates the MOF directly on the metal surface. So we did this by heating the metal surface, clamping the metal to a heating block, and in the solution were the building blocks for the MOF. And when you see the results down here, so this kappa things come from the clamps which you have up here, but the microscopy picture show you a very uniform, dense layer of this H-crust 1 MOF. So as I said, H-crust 1 is easy to prepare, which is a nice thing of H-crust 1. However, looking at the water stability, so the water loading over a certain number of cycles, you see that H-crust 1 quickly loses uptake capacity. So such a kappa MOF is not stable enough towards the water to be really employed as a working MOF for adsorption chilling. However, there are of course MOFs available which functions better because they are more stable, such as aluminum fumarate. This is an overlooked MOF to my opinion, although it's commercially already available by a BASF company. So it can be made on a ton scale, which is good, because for the technology which I'm telling you about, one would not just need a few grams of MOFs, one would need tons, or at least kilograms for prototype devices. So also this aluminum fumarate can be brought on an aluminum metal plate by the same process that you have just seen. Here are the microscopy and analysis pictures which show the development of a dense layer of a few hundred micrometers, also in quite a fast time. So this whole thing only takes a few hours to deposit the MOF on the metal surface. Then we have to, of course, to look, is the aluminum fumarate indeed stable enough? Is it hydrophilic enough? So here you see our key investigations. The uptake curves for water go from 0 to 0.4, so it's not so as porous as the MIL 101, because it only has a BET surface area of 1,000 square meters per gram. However, the water uptake occurs between 0.2 and 0.3, so in the right region for the technology. Also, the cycle stability is very good, so it doesn't lose uptake capacity. And here we have tested not only the bulk MOF, we also have tested the coating. And for the coating, it was possible to test not only 40 cycles, but 1,500 and even 4,500 cycles of water vapor add and desorption. And typically you can then also look at a powder X-ray diffractogram, and that is a good measure of the stability of a MOF. So you see that over these number of cycles, the powder X-ray diffractogram does not change. So the material retains its structure, which indicates stability. Another point is also that the thermal conductivity is better than active carbon, zeolite, or silica gel. So certainly, putting a MOF on a surface is one thing what the engineers asked for. Another thing is that they say, okay, could we combine perhaps the MOF with organic polymers, because organic polymers can be brought into many shapes. So maybe monolithic MOFs would be another possibility to derive at something which is more technically feasible than just microcrystalline MOF powders. So what as polymer we have chosen here a so-called HEMA-HYPE, a high internal phase emulsion polymer from hydroxymethyl metacrylate, and these polymers can be made macroporous. And in these macropores, which you see here, and these materials can also be manufactured in a monolithic shape, we can incorporate the MOFs. So here you see the green monolith. The green color comes from the chromium MOF. And we can load this polymer with up to 67% of MOF without losing mechanical stability. And we have tested several of these so-called high internal phase emulsions based on different polymers. Here you see a resorcinol formaldehyde Xero gel, which can do the same thing, incorporate the MOF up to 50-70% even without losing much of the mechanical stability. And again, we also had to found that the water uptake curve is shifted slightly to more hydrophilic values for MIL-101. And the water uptake is retained. So the pores of a MOF are not blocked by the polymerization process of a polymer if we do it correct. So with that, I'm already at the end of my presentation. Let me summarize. I've demonstrated to you a perhaps new type of possible application for metal organic frameworks besides the well-known gas storage, gas separation, namely water, reversible water absorption for cycling heat transformation. Of course, what is important if you work with water, the stability over time. So we have, as chemists, primarily looked at the uptake capacity and water stability of certain MOFs. You see down here the MOFs which we have looked at, and the three columns, black, red, and blue, depict the synthesized material, the material after 20 water absorption cycles, and after another 20, the next 40 water absorption cycles. And if the three columns are the same height and above a certain value, the MOF would be good. If heights diminish, the MOF would be not so good anymore. So you see that aluminum fumarate is good, MIL-101, MIL-100 iron would be good, and MIL-101 chromium, while and perhaps certainly also perhaps amino MIL-125, while other MOFs rapidly lose water uptake capacity. That means they are not stable enough for this process of uptake, of reversible water uptake for heat transformation. So another thing is, of course, to look at the hydrophilicity, so to have the water uptake occurring in the right region between 0.2 and 0.3 relative pressure. And in this region, mainly aluminum fumarate and amino MIL-125, and to some extent also mil 100 iron would be good for the mil 101 chromium, which has the highest uptake capacity. We would have to still try to make this material more hydrophilic somehow. So above all, just having MOFs as microcrystalline powders is no good, because, and that is true for any application. So in my opinion, also people working with MOFs, especially chemists, have overlooked that point. I mean, they overlooked stability for a long time, and second, they overlooked that MOFs, at least on a larger scale, can only be applied sensibly if they are somewhat formulated. So a microcrystalline powder doesn't work. So you have to bring them in some shape, perhaps as a monolith or on some surface, and that is an aspect which certainly should be followed by chemists to a larger extent, rather than preparing new MOFs, because by now we have about 20,000 MOFs available. That part of formulation of MOFs is certainly what needs more attention. So last but not least, I have to thank my group. So the work I've been talking about was mostly done by four people: Dominik Fröhlich, Felix Jeremias, Anupam Kutya, and Martin Wickenheiser, in collaboration with a colleague, Stefan Henniger, from the Fraunhofer Institute of Solar Energy. And I also have to acknowledge Dr. Vadisil Lozahan, who contributed to the Amino Mil 125 and the Amino UIO 66. So he prepared these compounds, and one publication in Dalton was together with him. So money was given by the organizations down here, and I thank you for your kind attention, for coming and listening to my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So, Marius, Andrew, no question, right? if someone has a question, I mean, I think it's a short question, maybe? Yeah, sure.
I understand the absorption of water is by heating. Is that correct? Can you do it by other way, pumping nitrogen, for example?
Certainly, the heating would go together with vacuum. So vacuum also would work, but certain vacuum alone would not be fast enough. So one would need both heating and vacuum, because water is rather strongly bound to active sites, and it's not so easy to desorb. And even if you, I don't know if you work with MOFs, I think you'd work with organic zeolites, because you will give a talk on that. So the activation part of a MOF, because initially one has solvent in there, is not so trivial to remove that. One has to combine heat and vacuum. So it was short enough.
Thank you very much. So I think we will stop at this point. Thanks again. So it's my great pleasure to welcome Professor Marius Andrew from Bucharest. He's going to give a talk on the beauty of coordination polymers. Please, Marius, maybe we need to put your presentation on.
So thank you very much for the invitation to attend this conference. It is always a great pleasure to be here, because I have a lot of friends and cooperation during the last 20 years with people from Moldova. Moreover, my both parents were born here, so my origins are in this country. And I knew also very well Professors Sturte and Revenko, and had long discussions with them, so I'm very happy to dedicate this conference, that you dedicated this conference to their memory. So why this strange title for you, simply because this is a hidden part of mine, so the acoustic part. So I'm fascinated, like many other chemists, by the beauty of the molecules and particularly of the coordination polymers. So, but we are not looking only for the beauty of the molecules, because our field will be sterile somehow. So we look also for the new synthetic approaches to enrich this chemistry, to describe new network topologies, and to investigate the magnetic properties, luminescence, or sorption of gases or catalysis that it was nicely developed before me by Professor Janiak. So we are looking for coordination polymers containing one kind of metal ions, the homometallic coordination polymers, the heterobimetallic with two metal ions, and much more complicated from the synthetic point of view are coordination polymers containing three different metal ions. And because I'm interested in magnetic materials, all three metal ions must be paramagnetic. So we have a large library of molecules that can connect the metal ions, which are very known. The synthetic approach is the one known as Noden spacer approach, and it was formulated for the first time by Richard Robson. So we have metal ions and the spacers, and during the self-assembly process we can obtain various coordination polymers with various dimensionalities or network topologies according to the stereochemical preference, especially of the metal ions. So if we ask students how can we describe better chemistry as being a puzzle or a Lego, so I think both answers are yes. We are interested, for instance, in total synthesis. Chemistry is rather a puzzle, but it's limiting, from my point of view, it's limiting the imagination. So I prefer chemistry as a Lego. So we have the pieces of Lego, and we can combine them and to obtain, using imagination, an infinite number of coordination polymers or molecules. So, an interesting aspect in the chemistry of coordination polymers consists of looking for coordination polymers mimicking basic crystal structures. So this was formulated for the first time again by Richard Robson. And he showed that we have, for instance, titanium dioxide structure. Can we mimic or construct a coordination polymer with the same topology? The answer is yes. We can choose a metal ion that prefers a coordination number of 6 and replace oxygen that is 3 coordinated through this ligand. So we have this trigonal symmetry, and this is a coordination polymer that mimic this basic structure in inorganic chemistry. So this is a collection of compounds described recently in my lab, where we have design compound with platinum sulfide, diamond cadmium sulfate, or quartz-like coordination polymers. For instance, this is the classical platinum sulfide structure. So we have a square planar motif here that is platinum 2, that prefers this stereochemistry, and sulfur that is tetra-coordinated. So we need two tetons, one square planar and the other one tetrahedron. So in a cooperation we have with Professor Gross in Cluj, he designed for us this tetrahedral molecule. So this one we replace sulfur. And then we need a square planar, but we have shown with this structure that it is not compulsory to have a square planar. It can be trans-octahedral, because if we have two water molecules here, this molecule have no importance on the final topology. And this compound that is obtained by reacting this ligand with copper has this platinum sulfide topology, and it is fourfold interpenetrating. So this is a classical story. So we have a tetrahedral synton. We can combine these tetrahedral syntons to obtain tetrahedral diamond-like networks. So this is the classical approach for coordination polymer consisting of copper ions and a bisphenidyl spacer. We can also construct such molecules, but replacing a metal ion by a heterocubane, because the four copper ions describe a tetrahedron. So we can add here a linear spacer like a dicyanogold anion, and we have the adamantane unit and for fold interpenetration of diamond-like nets. This is another ligand synthesized by Professor Gross in Cluj, and we reacted it with silver, and we obtained a diamond-like coordination polymer. Because this ligand is not very good, cyano can coordinate, the nitrile can be not so very good ligands, we have chosen hexafluoroacetylacetonato complexes, because the metal center has a higher Lewis acidity, in order to obtain such a coordination polymer. So, because it is octahedral, and the spacer replaced the two water molecules that are in cis, so we obtain a different topology that is planar, it's a layer, and not a diamond-like. Diamond-like could be if we have here the water molecules or the interaction with the spacer in the trans position. So this is quartz, another prototype in structural inorganic chemistry. So we have a tetrahedral synton and an angular oxygen here. So we can construct by choosing a metal ion that prefers the stereochemistry and an angular spacer. And this is a work done in cooperation with Maria Bazin in Brazil. So we have the tetrahedral synton here, that is copper, and a pyrazole carboxylic derivative that bridges the metal ions. So we have this beautiful quartz-like topology, and it crystallizes in the chiral space group. So it is a quartz-like coordination polymer. So our favorite synthetic strategy to obtain coordination polymers actually is based on systems containing two or more metal ions. So to use oligonuclear complexes as nodes in constructing coordination polymers. So for example, here we have alkoxo bridge that are spontaneously generated in solution by reacting copper with amino alcohols. So according to the denticity of the amino alcohol, we can construct in a rational way, we can control the dimensionality in a, of the coordination polymer in a rational way. So we can obtain 1D or 2D coordination polymers. So this is a new spacer that is that was synthesized by Christian Silvestro, and we used this one to construct coordination polymer. You may ask why this one and not 4-4 prime bipyridyl. Because mercury here brings new possibilities for the supramolecular interactions in the solid state. So it's different, it's completely different from the classical 4-4 prime bipyridyl. I don't insist on these supramolecular interactions here, but we published recently a paper in Christenschkom that describes the role played by the mercury in the packing of the molecules in the crystal. So I insist only on this compound. It is constructed from binuclear copper nodes. This is propanol amine. And the spacer is a 3D coordination polymer. And we have the cadmium sulfate topology and a threefold interpenetration of these nets. So we also synthesize spacers in our lab. So this is bisphenidyl azuline that was synthesized by one of my postdocs and Simona Nica in the Center of the Organic Chemistry at the Academy. And we obtained two interesting, from my point of view, coordination polymer, because we have combined two different spacers, and this is not so easy, because you can obtain mixtures of coordination polymers. So we have this compound with this angular spacer and 4-4 prime by PDD, and two trans cyanato groups. We can tune the dimensions of the meshes by changing the bisphenidyl derivatives. In this case, we have bisphenidyl ethylene. And because the cobalt centers are quite isolated in the crystal, we can expect interesting magnetic properties. Cobalt is very appealing because it has a strong magnetic, quite strong magnetic anisotropy, so we can expect a single molecule magnetic magnet behavior to make a pleasure to Rodolphe or to myself, single ion magnet here. So each cobalt ion acts as a magnet, and this is a simplified drawing of this polymer, and each we observe the slow relaxation of the magnetization of each cobalt ion. And with the same spacer, we obtained heterobimetallic coordination polymers. So we have nickel and lanthanides here, and the spacers we are just talking about. So what I like very much, as I told you before, are complexes with two different metal ions. Oligonuclear complexes. So this is a helicate which are synthesized currently in my lab, containing only cobalt 2 ions. So because the helicate is anionic, so we need cations. The cations are the sodium ions. So we have a nice 3D structures with layer made by sodium ions, which then the layers are connected by the helicates. So this is nice, but from the magnetic point of view, it's not very interesting, because we have four cobalt ions which are strongly antiferromagnetically coupled, so at low temperature it's nothing. So we decided to replace sodium with another paramagnetic metal ion, and we replaced two sodium ions through cobalt 2. And in this case, we have chains, and the cobalt is here, fifth cobalt ion is here. So this is a chain made by the sodium ions, and this one, and this one, and this one are strongly antiferromagnetically coupled, and the resulting spin is 1/2 of spin effective for cobalt 2, and this moiety acts as a single molecule magnet, but I don't want to enter into details now. So this is a library of the different oligonuclear complexes we are currently employed to construct coordination polymers. So I mentioned before that we can have such alkoxo-bridged binuclear nodes. We can tune the distance between the metal ions and the dimension of the meshes by replacing the spacers. We can obtain using zinc, that is colorless, luminescent coordination polymers. This is another one, it's a railroad-like 1D coordination polymer. And all the polymers I presented before are cationic, so the anions are looking are there, and they ask for space. So we decided to employ a dianionic generator for the nodes, in order to obtain a neutral coordination polymer with no anions asking for space. And indeed, we obtained with this building block, and using hexamethyl and tetramine, we obtain a 3D coordination polymer. The details are here. So hexamethyl and tetramine is a very cheap ligand. So this is an important condition when looking for applications, because we cannot employ as organic ligand molecules that are obtained in 20 steps and low yields. So this is very appealing from this point of view. So this is a 3D coordination polymer that preserves the crystalline and the structure up to 280 degrees. So we have removed the water molecules, and then the sorption of carbon dioxide, and moreover we observed carbon dioxide by recording the infrared spectrum that shows that the carbon dioxide molecules are there. So other coordination polymers have been synthesized in order to be employed as photocatalysts. This is a cooperation I have with Professor Kurulescu in Bucharest. So this is a 3D coordination polymer containing penta-nuclear zinc nodes. We can play on the nature of the spacer. You see here you can have 1,2 benzene dicarboxylic acid or 1,4 terephthalic acid, and we can change the topology of the resulting polymers. We can have also strict control on the over the nuclearity by employing such three compartmental ligands. So we have copper, copper, copper. The spacer is dicyanamido, so we can construct coordination polymer using three nuclear complexes as nodes, or much more complicated and more interesting. So we have such cavities, nanocavities, that are generated by connecting these three nuclear nodes by tetracarboxylic acids. So we are working now on this compound. We got the structure recently, and we spent a lot of time to understand this structure. So our chemistry is mainly based on vanillin to obtain heterobinuclear complexes like these. So we can have copper and another 3D metal ion or a lanthanide, and we can obtain complexes containing copper within the node, copper manganese and the trimethic acid, or oxobisbenzoic acid, or diacetanamido, and so on. So heterotrimetallic complexes are my favorite because it's more challenging from the synthetic point of view. So it's not so easy to put three different metal ions within the same molecular entity. So we need a synthetic approach that is based on preformed binuclear complexes using vanillin as a starting material. And so we have this together, and then the third metal ion, that is molybdenum 5, that is paramagnetic, so it's very interesting from the magnetic point of view. So this, we have 1,2, and the third metal ion are here, or here, or here, or here. So we have in these units potentially bridging ligands. So this is one example. So we have here tungsten 5. It is heteroleptic complex. This is a preformed precursor containing copper and gadolinium, and these are the magnetic properties showing that this interaction is ferromagnetic, and this one is antiferromagnetic. So we go here, but you see here, copper is pentacoordinated. So this explains us why we don't obtain a polymer. So in order to go towards a polymer, we need another ligand here. So we need a metal ion preferring a coordination number of 6, for example, nickel. And with nickel, indeed, we have, this is the asymmetric units of the other ligand is here, and indeed, we increase the dimensionality of the coordination polymer. So we have the three metal ions with one problem. We got a tungsten 4 during the reaction that is diamagnetic. So this is not very interesting at the beginning. It was not very interesting for us at the beginning, but looking carefully at the magnetic properties, we observed slow relaxation of the magnetization. That means each node here, each node acts as a single molecule magnet because the nodes are isolated by this diamagnetic unit. So we have a network of single molecule magnets. So this is another one with iron 3 in this case, and it's a nice 2D coordination polymer. All the three metal ions are paramagnetic, and you see here the magnetic properties. So this is a topology of the spin carriers. This is ferro. This is ferromagnetic. Probably probably this one is very weak antiferromagnetic. We don't know exactly whether we can describe it, so we must be very careful whether it is a single chain magnet or not. So we prefer to say that we have here, and we mentioned like this in the paper we published this year, that we have slow relaxation of the magnetization, because the chains where we have only ferromagnetic interactions are not magnetically isolated because of these possible interactions here. So other examples, and I finish. I will present only two examples with no lanthanide, so copper manganese, which are well held by the compartmental ligand, so the third metal ion, and following different crystallization processes, we can obtain various topologies. So we can have here, like, do you recognize or this one? This is a ferromagnetic chain, but it's a more complicated spin topology because we have here an antiferromagnetic interaction between copper and manganese, a resulting spin of 2, and then a small spin. So it is a ferromagnetic chain with a helicoidal topology. So I will stop here. The name of my co-workers were mentioned on each slide, so I'm very grateful to them and to the co-workers I have in France, in Spain, here. And thank you very much for your attention.
I think we have just a little bit of time if there's one question from the audience. Yeah?
You mentioned a network of single molecular magnets. Any long-range ordering, magnetic ordering in these systems, or do they remain isolated and disordered?
They remain like this for some of them, yes. For those, for the compound with a 2D structure, it's hard to say. So probably because we observed from the very beginning, we didn't observe the divergence of KIT at low temperature current that is characteristic for a chain. So.
Okay, if there's no more questions, thanks very much again. Final lecture just before lunch is Marius Reglier, and is going to talk about bioinorganic chemistry approach in the development of tyrosinase in